Welcome back to the second half, everybody. Freddie, who's next?
Tommy, our next guest is Mr. David McSavage.
Ah, brilliant.
Sorry, I'm so sorry, Tommy. Sorry.
Why are you sorry?
Good to see you.
Why are you sorry?
I'm just saying I'm sorry. Oh, for Christ's sake. That was very entertaining, the previous guest.
Yeah.
Yeah.
How are you?
I think I'm okay.
Where are you now in terms of your work and performing and earning a living and...
Well, thank God
..and being excited about what's coming up or anything like that?
Well, thank God for social media, because the penny only dropped with me in terms of how revolutionary Instagram is, for instance. Mm. And so, luckily, thankfully, I can sell more tickets now than I did when I was doing the Savage Eye. And that's as a result of having this ability to build an audience as a result of doing sketches and on Instagram. So it's like kind of like, because I used to be a street performer, so it's like street performing online. So, you know what I mean? Because I have burnt a lot of bridges and all that kind of stuff. And so this has given me light at the end of the tunnel.
Do you regret any of that? I don't want to get into the specifics of any of them, but I just want to give listeners an idea of the type of thing. So it might be with a promoter. It might be with somebody who runs a festival. It might be with somebody who runs a radio station. Are they the bridges you're talking? Might be a venue owner.
Yes. There was one guy who had kind of a powerful position in the comedy world. And I think when I was doing the Savage Eye, I used to do, I'd make up a character and use variations of his name.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Do you know what I mean?
Yeah, yeah.
It's kind of, so I would say a lot of my comedy actually is revenge fueled, you know.
Spiteful?
Yeah, possibly.
Is it?
Well, spiteful, well, justifiably vengeful. I mean, you might say spiteful, but I don't...
No, I'm throwing that out there as... know, I'm asking you, is that...
No, I don't think spiteful. Because spiteful sounds like you're just doing it and there's no reason to get back at this person.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
So, anyway.
Most comics that I know that... whenever we're talking about you... Mm. Would say that you're brilliant, and that, but each gig could turn if you decide that. I remember you saying to me one time that you would be watching how an audience are reacting to a particular comedian, and if you felt that they were giving him more laughter than he deserved, you would then go on stage
and punish the audience
and punish them.
Well, that was a long time ago, yeah. Mm. But it's definitely true. On many occasions, I'd hear a comedian getting big laughs who I didn't think was worthy of those big laughs, and then come on and say something to ruin the gig.
Yeah.
And then build them back up in my own kind of image or whatever. But actually, yeah, it's I guess that could be that is a bit spiteful or. I don't know. Yeah,
You've a lot of fans, David. You've a load of fans. And I'm one of them. And you know that.
Yeah. Do you know what this fuck? It feels like an interrogation. That's what this is. Because it's there's no audience, and it feels like, Tommy, you're the representative of all the comedians in Ireland. And this is an intervention. And look, David, you're going to have to pull up your socks and stop harassing the other comedians. Stop being vengeful. I can't help myself. No, but I think with in comedy, there are cliques.
Yeah.
And there are some comedians who are doing better than others. Yeah. And certain styles of comedy, for instance. And, you know, and the fact that I sometimes, or a lot of times, use a guitar, a lot of comedians who just have a mic and who would say that is the purest form of comedy, they'd look down on me. But then actors, for instance, or theatre actors look down on comedians.
Yeah.
And the thing is, yeah. So there's all this kind of competitive stuff going on within the comedy industry. But I kind of like it. I don't mind it.
Yeah.
And there's nothing wrong with people not liking you. But although I find it does shut me down. I'd get quite angry if I saw people getting offended in the shows. Like I'd sort of double down on what I was saying and really piss them off.
What's your feeling then? Say something like that has happened where you get people in it and they're kind of going, they're shaking their heads and they're kind of, you know, tut-tutting, and you go, okay, I'm going to layer it on you, layer after layer. What do you feel like when you walk off stage then?
Well, sometimes it can turn and it can be, and they can chill the fuck out and start laughing and relax.
Yeah.
And then other times, whatever shit that I'm pumping out to them, I walk off stage with and feel horrible and have to go home and sort of rock back and forth in a fetal position. But like, but it doesn't, I'm not as bothered about people being offended as I used to be. Because they have a right to be offended, but also nothing needs to be done as well. That's the other thing.
Yeah. Who do you hang out with?
Well, you know, I go to a lot of, I do a lot of gigs, so I hang out with other comedians.
Okay.
And I've actually started doing, believe it or not, a podcast with my ex-wife and my two sons.
I've heard about it.
Yeah, and that's a lot of fun because it's so we're hanging out together, not in the traditional way a family would hang out. You know, we actually have a purpose.
Yeah.
We're doing a podcast. Each of us has our role and we're slowly getting better.
Is it called?
And that's why we're not together.
So it's you and your ex.
Yeah.
And your
kids? She's my sidekick. And Jack is operating. Jack is my youngest. Daniel is my eldest. Jack is on he operates the sound. Daniel operates the video. But they contribute and they have their own section of the show. Daniel does some trivia about Nicolas Cage. And Jack has his little section of the show called Conspiracy Corner.
And is it all about how yourself and your ex don't get on? Did you have arguments and stuff?
No, yeah, we do have arguments. And there's always those little points in the show where the music comes in. And that's why we're not together. But, you know, it feels like a really good opportunity for me. I mean, I just love sitting with them. So that's good.
Do you have a sense of yourself as an outsider?
Jesus, Tommy, I don't even have, if you want to get honest, I have no idea what I should be or where I fit in. I know I have two sons and that gives meaning to my life. But in terms of, you know, society and being outside and being, you know, I'm not really sure.
I think you are. I think you're someone who's outside the mainstream. I think you're the kind of the dangerous genius in the bush.
Yeah.
That people are delighted to see but kind of scared to engage with.
Yeah.
And people don't like or really like. You don't make it easy for people. You know, I think you're an uncomfortable presence. I think you're kind of, but that's, professionally speaking, me and all the other comics that I know love that about you.
Yeah.
You know.
But that's an interesting, you know, because I've got to the age now where I'm okay with the fact that people don't like me, and I mean, no different to any comedian. Thank God there are enough people that, I mean, what I'm trying to say is, yeah, there are lots of people who don't like me as a comedian, but there are enough people who do like me, and thankfully I can make a living from that, if you know what I mean.
Yeah, yeah.
And what harm as well?
How are you getting older? Getting older, and what's changed in terms of
getting older? Well, I guess I'm probably in denial of it. I did start going to the gym recently, because the thing is, actually during lockdown,
what do you do at the gym?
Fucking lunges or whatever the fuck. And I pay a personal trainer because there's no way I'd do it without somebody just looking at you and telling you to do it. Because if I rely on my own brain.
Yeah.
I do fuck all. Well, look, I dyed my fucking beard, didn't I?
Oh, did you?
Yeah, I dyed my beard. I don't have as much grey as you do, but I dyed my beard to cling to the fucking...
Really?
Yeah, yeah. Why would you not dye your beard?
Are you dating?
Like, yes, yeah, yeah.
That's why you dyed your beard.
No, I also quiet, please, on the set. Fuck's sake, Tommy. RTE, go on. It's probably Ryan Tubridy scrabbling his way back in. He's my first cousin, did you know that?
I know that, and I also know that you're never on his Late Late.
Never on his fucking Late Late. 14 years, and thank you, Tommy Tiernan, for finally, after 15 fucking years, Oh, no, you didn't invite me.
I didn't invite
you. Because you didn't know.
No.
You didn't know. Yeah, you didn't know, Tommy, yeah. Fucking bullshit. Anyway.
Do your kids ever come to see your stand-up?
Yeah, I don't want them to, but they do, but they don't, they pretend they haven't.
Yeah.
Because the kind of things I'd be talking about, like, you know, I don't want my son's...
But
I don't want my son.
I imagine people would have sent them stuff on the phones and that. There's your dad doing this.
There's certain things. No, they have come to, anyway, yeah.
I think the stand-up suits you.
Yeah, yeah.
More than I've seen it suit a lot of other people. It just seems to fit with your...
Yeah, yeah.
Because you the stuff that you can say that is awkward in conversation or is mean or is a bit mental or in conversation.
Yeah.
It's kind of almost like when you do it on stage, it's almost that's where that kind of stuff belongs, isn't it? It's kind of like...
And I think people... appreciate, or somebody said a long time ago that you're, as a performer, you're kind of duty bound to say whatever pops into your head. People talk about sacred spaces. I would say the stage, you should be, there should be a sort of an allowance or a more of a space to fuck up.
Yeah,
because,
yeah.
You know, I will fuck up and I will, you know, and sometimes, but here's the thing though. I think people can recognize honesty and they find it very refreshing. And it's like it has a melody to it. It's like, you know, when you hear somebody sing in tune, you're like, oh yeah. And also I think people, they might disagree with you, but they'll really appreciate the honesty.
Yeah.
And, well, listen, here's the thing. And we can finish on this if you want. It's so weird. No, this is the actual answer you're looking for. If you saw how I acted in social situations, objectively, and you saw the way I was so desperate for attention, didn't matter what kind of fucking attention, whether it was, you're a fucking, or you're, hey, you're great, as long as people were paying attention to me, that was it.
Yeah.
And then you'd look at that person, and you think, he's acting as if he doesn't exist. You know, young people talk about, I identify as a fox. I would say when I was young, I identified as if I was not existing because I was so desperate for validation or whatever the fuck.
Yeah.
It was like pure drug or something. I mean, it was something I want to do that. But I didn't, I wanted that without putting the fucking work in. And then I'd want to get close to someone like you and be your mate. But I didn't feel worthy, and then I start drinking, and then ruin any potential of an actual friendship because I probably said something stupid when I was drunk or whatever.
Yeah, yeah.
But anyway.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Where are the next few gigs happening for you?
Oh, I've got a big gig coming up in Three Olympia on March the 14th. So you know, tickets are on sale for that.
Yeah. Yeah. Wow.
I might have sold out by now.
Good luck with the gigs, man, really.
Thanks for having me on. Well, you didn't have me on your show.
Fair play, David, thanks. Save.